David Sardi and doomsday preppers. Government hoards food, government hoards water, government hoards giant stockpiles of nuclear weapons and biological weapons, and that's reasonable and good to have a 20-year food supply and underground reactors, underground reservoirs, and giant armored mountains like Mount Weather and Cheyenne Mountain and Colorado Springs and all the rest of it. But if you have a fallout shelter or a storm shelter for hurricanes or tornadoes, if you even dare attempt in any way to have firearms and a year's supply of food and can some stuff like our forefathers just 50 years ago were doing. Forget forefathers, just 50 years ago that was standard. It is bizarre behavior. You can go to Communities Against Terrorism subsection of FBI.gov. There's literally hundreds of flyers they put out, and they tell repair people when they're in your house, do they have ammo reloading equipment? Do they have storable food? Did you see an arsenal of guns as if underground railways and all these systems that are admitted. But if we try to be prepared, we are evil. We are bad. It is crazy. I mean, I was crazy 13 years ago with Economist on the air warning of the end of the Glass-Steagall Act and the derivatives would be used to implode our economy and basically bring in a world government. And, of course, now they've announced the world government run by the mega banks that sold us the derivatives. It's in the Economist magazine, Reuters, AP. Ban Ki-moon called for it 2 weeks ago. But I'm still the bad man. I'm still the bad man. See, because being proven right in America and worldwide, that's what's wrong. If you're one of these CNBC liars giving you bad stock picks all day and wrong about 85% of the time, that's good. Being bad is being right, you see. So they have these shows, they try to pick eccentric people out and then try to make it look crazy that to prepare. And they've got executive orders to confiscate from hoarders. They call more than 1 week of food under executive orders. Look it up. Just type in executive order outlawing hoarding of food. It'll come up. It's been reissued more than 20 times because each new president has to reissue it or reissue a variance on it. It's been going on since Kennedy. And sometimes they reissue changes every year on it. So it's more than 20 times they've changed it. But it's all there. Takeover of communications. Takeover of all agriculture. Confiscation of all food. Confiscation of all firearms. It's all on the books. On the books! But our next guest, one of the most popular individuals on the hit, and I mean hit. Everybody I know talks about it. I don't really watch a lot of mainline TV, so I've only seen clips online. But everyone out there talks about doomsday hoarders on the CIA-run History Channel, or not History Channel, Nat Geo, same thing. So National Geographic, and he's on there. And a week ago, he put out articles on YouTube saying, help me, I went to the doctor, and they took my guns. And I've actually seen cases in the news, and we're going to them here in a moment, where you have heart surgery, and they say, we think you might be depressed, go on Prozac. And when you say no, they say, well, that's mental illness, not believing your doctor. We're taking your guns. Or sometimes the government just seizes you and even takes your property. They don't just have CPS that grabs kids, communist pedophile services. They also have these elder service people. And I'm not saying everybody in the bureaucracy is evil, but the overall driving force is. But here he is. I see cases in the news. They admit after Clinton left office, 89,000 veterans had their right to Second Amendment taken because they collapsed in Vietnam or got shot. They just added to their file post-traumatic stress disorder, even though they didn't even have it. No judge, no jury. Not even the 68 Gun Control Act says it. They lost their Second Amendment. And so I talked to so many vets who go to buy their grandson at 22. You know, they're 60-year-old Vietnam veteran. And they're just like, sorry, you can't buy it. And he goes, but I have no criminal record. Call the FBI. They call him. They go, we got some mental illness in your Army file, your Marine Corps file, your Navy file. I know clerks from the military who were never even in combat who can't own guns now. Side issue, let's go to the mind criminal, the evil person, the thought criminal that would dare try to store food, David Sardi. Good to have you on with us. We're going to break in a moment, but just give us a taste of what's coming up. Tell us what Hold on. There's the break. Again, I'm on the road. Don't have my clock in front of me, my trusty atomic clock. We're going to go to David Sardi right here. We'll do two segments with him, and maybe even longer, because Jim Mars just got here, but there's a Mexican food restaurant next door. He's here with his wife and family. He's like, can I get some enchiladas? And I'm like, you know what? Enchiladas and cold beer, that supersedes a radio show. Go over there and pound down some yummies. So the victim disarmament crowd that takes our tax money and creates a giant government armed to the teeth and training for war against the people, including 30,000 drones the federal government has now funded against the American people, spy satellites watching U.S. farmers for environmentalists that want to steal their property. It's all happening. And you go into the doctor, and, well, a few days later, they come and take all your guns. When you try to buy a gun, they say, well, you can't have one. And joining us is David Sardi of Doomsday Preppers on Nat Geo. Very popular individual out there, tens of millions a week that watch him, but he can't own a gun. No judge, no jury. Guilty until proven slave. Joining us is David. David, go ahead, tell us what happened to you, my friend.
Well, I heard you talking about veteran stuff. I don't know if you can see that right there. That's called an honorable discharge. I do have one of those. But anyway, I'm going to try to edit down this. Last year, back in, say, November, I thought I was having a heart attack. I was having chest pains, felt like I was suffocating. So I went to my doctor, and he referred me to this cardiologist. So that cardiologist sent me to some tests at a hospital. A month and a half goes by, and I haven't heard nothing from this guy. So I called him up, made an appointment. I went there, and he said, well, they didn't see nothing wrong with my heart. And I told him, I said, well, whatever was wrong, you know, I said, look, this was, you know, I felt like I was suffocating, and this was the closest I ever came to feel like committing suicide. Well, you know, that started it off. He said, are you going to commit suicide? I said, no, I'm not going to commit suicide. I'm not suffocating. I said, you know, suffocation, you know, drowning and stuff like that.
You're saying it was a figure of speech. It was a figure of speech.
Right. If I was, you know, it's like if the people that jumped out of the World Trade Center when it was burning, you know, what, you're going to burn, you're going to jump. You know, you got a choice. But anyway.
I told him I'm not going to commit suicide, man.
Right. I told him flat out I'm not. And he says, well, you know, when we could stick these tubes in you, you know, he's going to do some kind of trach and make it so you could breathe. I says, you know, if I have to live with tubes in me, I'd just as soon, you know, not get treated and go on. And, well, then he said, well, that sounds like suicidal to me. So I said, no, it's not. And then he says, well, you know, he mentioned that it wasn't my decision. And me being a libertarian, that flew all over me. So I proceeded to get...
Oh, not your decision. You will take the vaccines. You will eat GMO. You will take the fluoride. You will do what the little secret police officer, just like Hitler,
right,
hired all the doctors to work for him. Oh.
I said, look, everybody at one time or another thinks about it. And he said, well, I've never thought about it. And I called him, basically told him it was full of donkey poo. So, anyway, you know, that went on, and finally he said,
he was full of Bill Clinton.
Yeah. I thought, he said, you needed to go talk to somebody at the emergency room. I said, I don't have time. You know, I can't afford that emergency room. I got animals to feed on the farm.
You said, you're full of Janet Reno. You're full of Janet Napolitano.
Right.
He said, he says, get over there to the emergency room. And he said, you're full of the federal government. Go ahead.
Yeah, and then, you know, I said, look, I don't have time for this. I have animals. I got dogs locked up in the house and you know, and everything else. So I went out in the hall, and I heard him calling the sheriff's office. So I skedaddled, and I went home. And maybe
again,
10
they're
minutes.
Just looking because the government's turning them into spies. And coffee shop people are told, folks that are buying cash, call the FBI on them. That's an actual FBI flyer. I'm not joking, folks. I got a video up on Infowars.com about it. My point here is, you're like simply saying, I'm having chest pains. God, this is horrible. It's like maybe I want to kill myself. It's so horrible. You're not going to kill yourself. No, it's a figure of speech. We're going to stick tubes down you and trach you. Well, that's crazy. I'm walking around here in your hospital. I'm saying I've got pain here. And then he's like, well, this is just the way it is. And look, I've had allergy attacks so bad when I made a mistake and rode a bike long distance, like 20 miles. about 5 years ago with my buddy. I went on this long distance, 20-mile, a lot of it mountain biking, while the cedar was popping, or the mountain juniper is what it really is. We call it cedar. And I'm driving home, and I feel like I'm having a heart attack. I can't breathe. Then I get a migraine. And I went to the doctor the next day, and they said, you had a complete allergy attack. This has happened to a lot of people. After I explained I'd been exercising, I'd smelled so much of that cedar that it just coated everything, including my lungs and everything. But I guess I deserve to have my guns taken. Continuing, so you go out there in the hall. He is now calling the sheriff.
Right. Well, I heard you know about the sheriff, so I left and I went home. And anyway, about 10 minutes after I got here, the sheriff deputies come up, and, you know, the logic of sending somebody with a gun after somebody that's going to commit suicide fails me. But, you know, I went out there and talked to them, and they told me that, I was going to have to come with them. And finally, he said, well, you know, you go to the hospital, they'll turn you loose, and he'll even give me a ride back home. So I said, all right, let's get this straightened out. So they didn't cuff me or nothing. They put me in the car, and they took me to the hospital. Well, I talked to this other woman, I guess she was a doctor, after sitting there for about an hour, and, you know, talked to her, and I signed an agreement saying, look, I'm not going to commit suicide and all like that. So an hour more goes by. And then, you know, I was like, hey, wait a minute. You know, what's going on here? And then I says, well, look, I'm a prisoner. I considered myself a prisoner, and I stopped cooperating. So I said, no, you're not getting no more blood pressures. I'm not talking to you no more. I want an attorney. And as soon as I said that, that's when they put me in the mental institution at McFarland for observation. And
again, just like the Soviets and the Nazis and the communist Chinese, every dictatorship in the last 100 years has used the mental system as a way to get around due process that everybody fought for. And, you know, if there's a crazy guy on the street corner who thinks he's Joan of Arc, they let him run around with feces running down their legs, drinking Schlitz malt liquor all day. They could care less if you commit suicide. They could care less if you're really crazy. They use it to harass people politically, and I've seen this so many times. So continue. Next, you get your guns taken, correct?
Well, no, they took my rights. I found out about it by accident. I mean, I just got the letter saying I had to surrender my my handgun permit, but I found out about it because I had been saving up for a Glock 21. And I got out a week later. I had the money. I got my YouTube money, and I said, I'm going to go get my Glock. I got turned down. So then I did an immediate appeal right there as soon as I got turned down, and that's when I found out about the paper. You have been declared
a mental
defective.
And by the way, the federal 68 Gun Control Act doesn't give them the power to do that. You had not been adjudicated mentally ill or committed, but they just color of law do it. It's felons under the 68 Gun Control Act that can't own guns, but it's just like color of law how they ban importation of guns to this country. It's not a law, but like Obama promised to do to Sarah Brady 2 years ago, he said, don't worry, I'm going to get their guns under the radar, like shipping guns to Mexico to blame the Second Amendment.
Well, basically, I was put in there. I feel they put me in there because I made them mad because I said I was being a prisoner, and I called them a bunch of, basically, I told them they were Gestapo at the hospital. Oh, we're doctors, they say. You're not a prisoner. I said, can I go? They said, no. I said, I'm a prisoner, and you're keeping me here against my will. So, you know,
they take people's kids that don't take vaccines at birth, even though there's no law. They are a bunch of authoritarian scum. I have witnessed it myself. They might be a nice person to play golf with or go to church with, but they're on these little power trips, and our rights mean jack diddly squat to them.
Well, see, that's when they wanted, you know, when I got to the hospital, I got this other little doctor that wants to give me these things called Zeprahodone, whatever it is. It's a psychotropic drug, and I refuse that. So that was another black mark because I was refusing
their
drugs.
You got to take their deadly chemical weapons or you're evil.
Yeah, so.
Which, by the way, those psychotropic drugs on the insert say they make you crazy and make you commit suicide.
Oh, that's what
it took us years to get them.
Yeah, I got the printout of the drug immediately from the nurse's station, and I read all the stuff. And that's one of the things it says. It says,
but see, because you're the type that would read a drug insert, you're the bad man. You're the terrorist. You're the problem. We'll be right back. We'll give people your YouTube channel. And I'm going to get you on later this week for a full hour to talk about how we support you. Because if we don't hang together, we hang separate. If they can trump up charges to take your Second Amendment, they can do it to anybody.